Hello, ladies and gentlemen, my name is Mr. Tardis, and let's cast our minds back to the long, long time ago. 2018, specifically February 2018, when the Marvel Studios movie Black Panther was about to be released. Now, the film's release date was mid-February 2018, but 2 weeks earlier, there were news stories of a Facebook group called Down With Disney's Treatment of Franchises and Its Fanboys, headed by a self-professed alt-writer who wanted to spearhead an organized effort to give Black Panther a low audience score on Rotten Tomatoes. The event, which had around 4,000 people who said they were interested in taking part in, read, "Given the massive success of the audience review rigging on the Rotten Tomatoes site for Star Wars The Last Jedi, and due to the sudden rise in those disgruntled with Disney business practices, among other factors, especially due to the corporate manipulations which created falsified bad press for the DCEU, I feel it's time to strike back at all those under Disney and bring down the House of Mouse's actions for paying off the critics that hurt DC Comics on film and for other parties affected by them. I'll be making events like this for Infinity War and the Netflix shows, etc., so we can rally together to truly make a difference. Share this with your friends and all potential sympathizers." Now, there was no way to actually post an audience score at the time because, well, the film wasn't actually out yet. There weren't any reviews for the movie from professional critics at this time either. Nevertheless, because of some imagined bias against the DCEU from critics who actually gave Wonder Woman incredibly positive reviews less than a year prior, this group wanted to manipulate the user metrics on Rotten Tomatoes for their own agenda, regardless of how the actual film itself turned out, because no one had seen it yet. Fast forward 4 months later, when the awards heavyweight GOTY was released, the film found itself with a pretty impressive 0% on Rotten Tomatoes in terms of critic scores, and the critics' consensus reading, "Forget about it." It's pretty funny. However, Dan Murrell of Screen Junkies did a really interesting video talking about how the disparity between the audience score and the user score just didn't add up, with many of the audience reviews being made by people who had just set up accounts, with many of those accounts having only reviewed GOTY, and others having only reviewed GOTY and American Animals. Both of these films were owned by MoviePass, which is already suspicious, but it's not helped that the distributor of GOTY even used this supposed critic audience divide in their marketing. And fast forward another 4 months later, and we find fan campaigns hitting the headlines again, with a supposed campaign by fans of Lady Gaga to try and support the film A Star Is Born and leave negative reviews for Venom, with the exact same copied and pasted reviews being posted all across Twitter to try and influence public opinion, with a fan supposedly confessing to BuzzFeed, with one of these accounts telling them, "It's us Gaga fans creating fake IDs to trash the Venom premiere. They both are getting released on the same day, so we want more audience for A Star Is Born." Even though it's likely that this was just someone trolling BuzzFeed with a false confession, fans who were excited for Venom hit back with their own counter-campaign. So even if that last example did not involve Rotten Tomatoes, I think these three examples are all linked with each other. When it comes to a online consensus amongst movie fans, there are many instances where audience metrics just cannot be trusted, whether it's fans trying to influence Rotten Tomatoes, movie studios trying to create alternative buzz for their shitty movie, or bots on Twitter trying to give one film negative buzz to help another one. I think it's safe to say that audience metrics can't always be trusted, and at the very least, should always be approached with caution and an understanding that they can't really represent an actual consensus. Unless those metrics say what you want them to say.
And then we hear from the audience, and oh look, a 45% audience score for Doctor Who Series 11.
Well received by critics, yes. Well received by the audience, no.
When I see numbers like this, where we have 94% for the critic score and a whole whopping 35% for the audience, this kind of tells us that maybe your critics are no longer necessary.
There we are, Doctor Who Season 11. The audience score is down to 29%. 29%, with the average rating 2 out of 5. That stings.
Well, it's just as George Santayana once said, those who do not learn from history don't give a shit, because we need YouTube clicks, son. Now, I think the first person to point out this low Rotten Tomatoes score was Nerdrotic Channel. In fact, in his top 6 most viewed videos on his channel, 4 of them are about Rotten Tomatoes. Wow, so this guy is taking that audience score pretty seriously. Let's hear what he has to say.
We know what most of the critics thought. They were all pretty friendly. None of them were going to get caught dead criticizing Jodie Whittaker, the first female doctor. Some of them might lose their jobs over that. And that's why we call them access shill media. And that's why people are running to YouTube channels so they can get a little honesty. So let's take a look at some of these critics and what they said about the finale and season 11 overall. From the mostly friendly IndieWire, Doctor Who Season 11 review standalone episodes failed the 13th Doctor. Showrunner Chris Chibnall failed to give the Doctor a real story over the course of the first season on the show. The Audio Video Club, Doctor Who season finale is a bit of a letdown. The very friendly Digital Spy, Doctor Who Series 11 Episode 10 review Battle of Ranskur av Kolos isn't the finale we were looking for. The new monsters don't work, bring back the Daleks. From The Guardian, too touchy-feely? Yes, it was. This is from the very friendly Radio Times. Doctor Who, the Battle of Ranskur av Kolos review, a triumph of style over substance? This is far from a high-stakes finale.
Okay, firstly, you say that critics were pretty friendly because if they criticize Jodie Whittaker, they're going to get fired. Where is the precedent for this? Where is the precedent for critics getting fired for being mean to a TV show? Because seconds, literally seconds after you said critics were friendly and positive, you showed and read headlines of pretty ho-hum to negative reviews of Series 11. Maybe those folks did lose their job over those reviews, like Morgan Jeffrey of Digital Spy. Oh no, he's still there. Okay, but what about Caroline Seed from AV Club? Oh no, her Twitter still has her as an AV Club contributor. We're only 1 minute into this video, and we've had massive contradictions and just a flat-out lie about Series 11 naysayers losing their jobs over criticizing this series, but okay, let's continue.
Everybody else has been calling this a triumph, the greatest season of Doctor Who with the greatest episodes of Doctor Who, and then we hear from the audience.
Wait, this is really confusing me because what he is saying in his commentary doesn't actually line up with what's on screen. I've actually looked over those reviews that he's putting up on screen here, and the word triumph is never said. He says that critics said that this was the greatest season of Doctor Who whilst showing this 3 out of 5 star review from the Financial Times. Blimey, what did the Financial Times think of the previous seasons?
And then we hear from the audience. And oh, look, a 45% audience score for Doctor Who Series 11.
But most of the rest of this video is taking up with Nerdrotic cherry-picking negative Rotten Tomatoes reviews and this little gem of a comment.
And this goes on and on for 94 pages and counting. And yes, there are groups of 5-star reviews, and I find that very curious.
Yeah, because maybe some people liked the series. People can have different opinions, you know, but because they don't line up with your opinion, they're curious 5-star reviews. This mention of 5-star reviews is the only mention of it in the whole video. He doesn't say why they're curious, he doesn't read any of them, he just says there are some 5-star reviews, but they don't count for reasons.
But you also got to remember, you may or may not know this, that not all of these reviews are counted to the percentage. They don't count a lot of half-star and one-star reviews, so it's actually worse.
There is zero evidence that Rotten Tomatoes does not count half-star audience reviews, and Nerdrotic provides no evidence to back up this, quite frankly, baffling claim.
And that's why people are running to YouTube channels so they can get a little honesty.
But when Nerdrotic made this video, Doctor Who had a 45% audience score, an average rating of 2.8 out of 5, and 1,876 user ratings. By the time Clownfish TV got around to it, the score had gone down to 30% with an average rating of 2.1 out of 5 and 3,208 reviews. Gee, it's almost like when someone with a platform pointed out a user metric with no barrier to entry that people leapt on it to promote their own agendas. But anyway, Clownfish TV, to his credit, actually does bring up that Rotten Tomatoes is not an accurate metric.
And before you say, hey, Rotten Tomatoes isn't accurate, yes, I completely agree that Rotten Tomatoes can sometimes not be accurate, especially if people are trying to either artificially inflate a show's or a movie's ratings, or they're trying to tank it for whatever reason. However, we look at other situations like the Netflix She-Ra show, which, you know, has a ridiculous 100% on Rotten Tomatoes, but did not receive a certified fresh sticker, by the way. And its audience score was low like this, and then Tumblr caught a whiff and it went up to like 75%. So let's take a look here and see what people are actually saying about Doctor Who Series 11.
Wait, that's where you end that topic? You even give an example about how Rotten Tomatoes user scores can be abused by people who want to change a show's public perception. You even give an example with She-Ra. I mean, you don't show any sources or citations or proper examples or numbers, but still, you vaguely give an example to prove your point, and then you just drop the point to talk about how bad the audience ratings for Doctor Who are. So Clownfish TV knows that Rotten Tomatoes can be abused, but because this particular score says what he wants it to say, then he just sidesteps that issue. Then why even bring it up? Clownfish TV, your agenda is showing. I was so taken aback by this sudden diversion, this sudden change, that I just had to know, what did Clownfish TV think of the new She-Ra? And well, he's not a fan. The reason he dropped that point is because that was his point. He doesn't directly say it, but with the added context that he's not a fan of She-Ra, it seems to be suggesting that the low Rotten Tomatoes score for She-Ra was, in his mind, the true score that he agreed with. Then folks from Tumblr came along and shifted the score. So he doesn't bring up this example to try and be balanced and nuanced and show how Rotten Tomatoes can be skewed, but how it can be skewed in favor of shows that he does not like, as opposed to the other way around, essentially saying that Rotten Tomatoes is not a reliable metric when it disagrees with his own personal perception. So Clownfish TV does the same cherry picking of negative reviews that he personally agrees with, and then shows this chart of Rotten Tomatoes audience scores for the revived series of Doctor Who to show how drastic the drop-off is. But here's the thing, Series 1 to Series 7 of Doctor Who only average around 700 to 800 audience reviews. In fact, those pages are so poorly maintained and managed by Rotten Tomatoes that they don't even have the correct poster for the different seasons. Series 6 has the right poster, but look at this, that was just a pure accident. Even though Series 1 has the poster for Series 7 Part 1, Series 7 still has the Series 6 poster. I don't know why this is so funny. It's not until Series 8, when Rotten Tomatoes was branching out to more TV review stuff, that the reviews reach four figures. Then Series 9 gets 800 reviews, and then Series 10, 600. The chart shows Series 11 with around 3,000 to 3,500 reviews, around 2,000 more reviews than the next competitor, Series 8. This is not a useful chart. The sample sizes are completely off base with each other and would be thrown out of any academic report or mathematical report. Speaking of not useful charts, he also brings up this one, showing the viewing figures for the revived series of Doctor Who. And I know that this is not a viewing figures video, but this chart is also not useful. For Series 4, this chart counts the 2009 specials, which is just not remotely fair. Look at that, it lumps them in with the other Series 4 stories, and that becomes the average. But also, those figures are not the official BARB figures for Series 11. They do not count the four-screen dashboard figures, meaning that those numbers for Series 11 on this chart are lower than the actual numbers for Series 11. This chart is just so askewed. Clownfish TV, you can't just shove charts in front of people that have been possibly skewed and tampered with just to force a narrative. Charts don't make everything automatically better. So at the time of writing this video, Doctor Who has a 22% on Rotten Tomatoes, with an average rating of 1.7 out of 5, and there have been 6,247 reviews left on the website. Now, I won't do what these other YouTubers did and just cherry-pick reviews to read out here. I'll actually do something useful. So, 22% of 6,247 is 1,374 positive reviews, leaving 4,873 negative reviews. So, when people say the Whovians have spoken, what they mean is just under 5,000 people have left negative reviews on a website. The Whovians have spoken, have they? Well, the least viewed story of Series 11 was It Takes You Away, with 7-day figures of 6,420,508. So let's say that that is just the nadir of Series 11 in terms of viewing figures. That is the minimum amount of Whovians who can speak. Okay, so out of 6,420,508, we have 4,873 leaving negative reviews, which means this Rotten Tomatoes score reflects the angry thoughts of 0.075%, a literal fraction of a percent. In fact, that 6.42 million figure for It Takes You Away was just the UK viewing figure. Rotten Tomatoes accepts reviews from all other countries. Doctor Who is estimated to have a global reach of 90 to 100 million people, so a sample size of 6,000 reviews, both positive and negative, it's just peanuts. It can't be used to truly get across the audience reaction to a TV show, and that goes for any audience metric for that matter, not just Doctor Who. Now, I know what you folks are gearing up for. You're waiting for me to say that the certified fresh positive tomato meter score for Doctor Who Series 11 is the one that we should be trusting. And no. Let's take a look at those actual reviews, because while that critic rating sits at 93% certified fresh, the average rating is 7.35 out of 10. There's a difference between 93% of critics liking the show and the average score being 7.35. Those two mean very different things. The benchmark for a positive score on Rotten Tomatoes is typically 3 out of 5, or 6 out of 10. So let's say that 100 critics saw a movie or a TV show and all of them just gave it a 3 out of 5, which is a decent score. Not raving, not overly positive, but not negative either. It's the borderline good review. However, that would mean, if all 100 critics gave it that score, that would give it 100% on Rotten Tomatoes, but a 6 out of 10 on the average rating. So that tomato meter, it's not everything. So let's actually just look at those reviews that gave Doctor Who that tomato meter. One handy thing Rotten Tomatoes does is list the reviews in the order they were released, and you can see that 26 of those reviews were put on the site before the premiere of The Ghost Monument. So there's 26 reviews on this website that are just for The Woman Who Fell to Earth. They're not for Series 11 as a whole, just the opening episode. Heck, only 5 of those reviews came out after the Battle of Ranscott Ab Coloss, and the rest of those reviews came out in dribs and drabs throughout Series 11. On this page, out of 38 reviews, only 5 of them reflect the actual series as a whole, or at least were written after the Battle of Ranscott Ab Coloss. Also, there's only 38 reviews. There are hundreds and hundreds of publications online, yet here we only have reviews from 38 of them. This is such a shallow pool of critics to draw from, and this isn't me thinking that there's some liberal conspiracy to try and boost Doctor Who's critic score. If you look at TV shows just across all of Rotten Tomatoes, the pool of critics for their TV shows is pretty tiny. The Good Place, 40 reviews, Daredevil, 54, True Detective, 38, The Bodyguard, 64, Game of Thrones, without question, the biggest show on the planet, 49. Outlander, 9. 9! And it's certified fresh. How can it be certified? Certified when the reviews don't even come to the double digits. Certified fresh. Wide release films with 75% or higher that are reviewed by at least 80 critics. 80? We have 9 here. Now compare those numbers to the pool of critics they draw from for movies. Aquaman, 316, Bumblebee, 207, Mary Poppins Returns, 299, Mission Impossible Fallout, 376, Bohemian Rhapsody, 339, Fantastic Beasts and the Crimes Against Filmmaking, 277, Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse, 324, The Favourite, the definition of a small award contender film, and not a big tentpole release that everyone is paying attention to, 295. Now, this does not automatically mean that these scores are better or worse than the TV ones. For example, we have Armand White, who was that guy who posted a negative review of Toy Story 3, but his initial review mentioned, without irony, that one of the villains in the daycare was Ham the Piggy Bank. But Armand White aside, Rotten Tomatoes is drawing from a much larger pool of critics for their movie pages. Regardless of my own personal thoughts on Series 11, a critic pool of 38, 25 of which are only reviewing one episode, the debut episode of the series, it's not remotely an accurate indicator of quality, and I certainly wouldn't be awarding it a Golden Tomato Award, though considering how much stock these folks have been putting in Rotten Tomatoes is, in my opinion, a hilarious twist to this saga. Like, The Orville Season 2 has 100% on Rotten Tomatoes, but it only has 9 reviews. I don't know, maybe critics are being too friendly on The Orville in case they get fired or something. And that, folks, is how easy and how little thought it takes to push a conspiracy on YouTube. But here's the thing, Nerdrotic has made a video called The Orville, 26% Rotten Tomato, Critics Score Proves They Are Irrelevant. That's the Rotten Tomato score for Series 1. For Series 2, like I said, it stands at 100%. Nerdrotic has yet to comment. I guess those critics are only irrelevant if they disagree with you. Folks, this isn't a remotely rational mindset. Critics have a bias against the DCEU. Until they don't. critics have a bias against the Orville. Until they don't. Rotten Tomatoes is a site that is open to abuse and manipulation to fit an agenda. Unless it's my agenda it's being manipulated towards. Here is Nerdrotic talking about the Orville's 26% on Rotten Tomatoes, and as you listen to him, keep in mind that Series 2 has a perfect score on Rotten Tomatoes.
Caesar C. sums it up perfectly. Simply a fantastic, fun sci-fi series. The critics seem to brood in the darkness of new sci-fi. Caesar is right. The critics are brooding because they got their hand caught in the shill jar. They're also living in fear. Fear of losing their access and fear of these giant companies that are gobbling up all the little ones. And there's not going to be many left. And some of them own the entities that they work for. BBC, CBS, Disney. The best example is comicbook.com, which is owned by CBS, which is a comic book website that has also turned into public relations for Star Trek Discovery. And gone are the days of Siskel and Ebert and Rex Reed and most of the old-time critics with actual integrity.
There's a lot to unpack here. I don't understand his argument. Critics are shills, they have conflicts of interest, but this is a video talking about negative reviews. So they're being paid to write negative reviews against products made by their parent companies? What sense does that make, and what are you even trying to suggest here? But anyway, take this comment that Nerdrotic makes against Liz Shannon Miller, who gives the Orville Season 1 a negative review.
Now, credit where credit is due. Liz Shannon Miller did not like Doctor Who either. She just hates everything. Just kidding. The only unique sounds made by the Orville are things we wish we'd never heard. What does that even mean? I'm going to have to go to the article. We go to her full review, the Orville review. Seth MacFarlane's Star Trek ripoff is creatively, morally, and ethically bankrupt. Did she watch the whole show?
Now here's Liz Shannon Miller giving the Orville Season 2 a positive review. It may not want to be a space spoof, but if it's able to fully evolve into a character-driven dramedy that just happens to be set in space, then that's adding something unique to the genre. And that could make the Orville a show worth watching. Rating B. And the actual review headline says, Season 2 premiere Joe Loggia, sorry, I've not watched the show, I don't know how that's pronounced, might be the show at its best. It's all character stories in the Fox Space Adventure series' return, and that's a good thing. Nerdrotic has yet to comment. So, while I don't always put much stock in Rotten Tomatoes scores from critics, I also don't put much stock in a score that has clearly been co-opted by a mob with an agenda and an axe to grind. Before I end this video, I just want to mention that IMDb can be just as bad, if not worse, because once upon a time, you could write reviews and post scores on IMDb before the film was even released. In fact, this allowed Christopher Nolan's The Dark Knight Rises to be in the IMDb Top 100 3 months before it even came out. And Christopher Nolan fans have a habit of trying to co-opt IMDb scores by giving films like Shawshank Redemption and The Godfather 1 out of 10 reviews, and giving films like Dunkirk and Interstellar 10 out of 10 reviews to try and skew the metrics. This tactic, it's not new. In fact, it's so commonplace that there's even a term for it, coined by Jim Sterling. Meta-bombed. But at the end of the day, these are just numbers. These are just bits of code online. Some of them are made by qualified professionals, some of them are made by attention grabbers, and they're also made by everyone in between. But what critics say, or what audiences say, should not impact what you think. For example, the movies like American Hustle or American Sniper or Three Billboards Outside Ebbing, Missouri, they have really good Rotten Tomato scores. For example, American Hustle stands at 92% with an audience rating of 74%, but I think the film is terrible. But I'm secure enough in my own opinion that I'm not going to try and hunt for conspiracies or try and dogpile the review scores. My thoughts just lie outside the general consensus, and that's fine. These numbers, these scores, whether they be from critics or audiences, are only as powerful or as useful as you make them. And online, there are discussions all the time that are years old that a critical or audience consensus does not always measure a movie's or a show's success. Bumblebee and Spider-Verse got great reviews, but box office receipts aren't great. Venom was mauled by critics, but it made $800 million worldwide. People, you already know this. But considering how many people are making this many videos about Doctor Who's Rotten Tomatoes score, despite the fact that the systems are ripe for abuse and some of them even admit as much, whilst also misrepresenting what those ratings mean or how those ratings are calculated, and also the past pattern of behaviour, even as recently as 2018, and also how these scores are no measure of a piece of media success, we have one of two scenarios here. Neither of them are good. We either have people who do not know that these systems are ripe for abuse despite years and years of examples, and they don't know what these numbers mean, in which case, why are these people even talking about them? Or secondly, these people know that these numbers are not accurate and are ripe for abuse, but they're counting on you, the audience, not knowing. These numbers only have power if you give them power. Be secure in your own subjective opinions on a TV show or a movie and just get along with your day. These Rotten Tomatoes audience scores, do they matter? In my opinion, no they don't. But in my opinion, they don't really have much stock regardless of what they're reviewing. But that's all I have to say, so thank you very much for watching this video. Be sure to subscribe for more TV or Doctor Who related content. I'll see you folks next time.